So feel free to question me, and if you feel the need to do so. So the first thing I would like to say, that whenever you do ecosystem science, you never do it by yourself. There's always people that you rely on, whether it's technicians in your lab or other people. There's a large group of other people I've worked with. I've worked with Marcus on and off and on different projects. But this group of three people are kind of the core group that we're working on Hypoxia together right now. I should also mention that we've been generously supported by a variety of different people. As I say, I'll take money from anybody, but they have been really good in supporting our science. So one of the things I was told when I first got here was that you guys come from a whole range of different countries, and I think it's so important to get this perspective and to talk to one another. Especially, for example, on Christoph Humberg's talk last night, where he was talking about nutrient reductions in Poland. And, you know, what do the Polish think about this? And I think this is important to involve this in a conversation. So I don't need to say much about the Baltic, but this is part of the core of the problem. We have a lot of people that are in the watershed that use it to grow their food and also put their waste into it as well. But there are other important things cultural around the Baltic that I think are extremely important. And the first, I've spent a lot of time in Finland working with a variety of different colleagues. And so what do you know most about Finland? What's the thing that comes to mind first?
Reindeer.
Trees.
Trees, reindeer.
Reindeer.
For me, it's the sauna. So, and they're nicer saunas than this one, but yeah, I think about saunas. I also lived in Denmark for 12 years, and it's very special, but there's no one here from Denmark. But what do you think of when you think of Denmark?
Sausages,
okay. Beer is one of them. I think of Danish pastries. So, and then the final thing is I live in Sweden now, and this is really important. And it's important because I don't know what you have planned for the next days. So what's like one of the most important things here in Sweden?
Water.
Fermented. There you go. So I hope you guys have a fermented herring party. The first time I ate herring was here on the island. So, and it wasn't the last time, but that's another story. So, okay. So what am I going to talk about? I'm going to talk about hypoxia. I'm going to talk about when it occurs, where it occurs, and some of the why that it occurs. I'm going to talk about Baltic inflows. I don't know how much you've gotten before. I know Christoph talked about it last night. I have very strong feelings about this, and I'm going to express them to you, and you can agree or disagree with me. I've had people shake their head in the audience before, so it's okay. No one has thrown stuff, but otherwise, it's okay. I want to talk about the consequences of hypoxia in the Baltic and what those consequences are. And then the last part, I'm going to talk about the future, and it includes geoengineering. And I've been outspoken about geoengineering, and I ask a lot of questions, and there are people that aren't happy with me. So you can decide whether you're happy with me or not for asking questions. So the most important thing to remember about hypoxia, there's two important conditions that must be met to have hypoxia. And the first one is stratification of the water temperature, or water column. It can happen from changes in temperature, it can happen for changes in salinity, or it can happen for changes in circulation or reductions in circulation. So it's when you trap water in a particular basin and you're not renewing that water is one of the conditions that you need to have. So in areas that are well flushed, you don't see hypoxia. But in areas that have restricted circulation or have strong stratification, you see hypoxia. But that often is not enough. You need a second feature. You need organic matter. You need organic matter to be decomposed and consume oxygen. And that's the other important thing that you need. And organic matter often comes from nutrients, of course. And so it's the nutrients that grow the organic matter that creates the hypoxia. But it also can come from other sources of organic matter, and I'll talk about that in a couple of minutes. So I have a series of questions. I have, I think, six questions scattered throughout here. So I want you to spend 1 or 2 minutes talking in groups of twos or threes. And I want you to tell me, I want to see how smart you are, and if you've read my papers. tell me, where does hypoxia occur in the Baltic Sea? Where does it occur? So, okay, go for it. Okay, so where does it occur? If you shout it out, let's create chaos here. Where does it occur? Anybody?
Mostly in the deepest parts.
The deepest parts, that's good.
But also in shallow parts more and more.
Okay.
Seasonal hypoxia.
Okay, so the deepest parts like the Bothnian Sea?
Around Gotland.
Around Gotland, okay. And you said in the coastal zone? Okay. Anyone want to add anything to that? So where doesn't it occur?
In the surface.
It doesn't occur in the surface? That's important. It's a really good answer, actually. Does it occur in the Bothnian Sea?
No.
How come it doesn't occur in the Baltic Sea, the Bothnian Sea?
Weaker halocline.
Yeah. I think it's the last lack of organic matter, because it still has a permanent halocline in the Bothnian Sea. Okay, you'll see other places where it doesn't occur, and I'll get to that for a minute. I'm just trying to make you think and wake you up after lunch. So I have ordered rain, so it rains the next 2 hours, so you don't feel bad about being in here. And, so oxygen is one of the most important things that you need as a higher organism. They call these low oxygen zones dead zones, but they're actually very microbially active. There are really lots of cool biogeochemical reactions that occur because of the so-called redox ladder, this different organisms that are there. It occurs in a variety of different places. This was an amazing estuary in Denmark. Mayafjord is how they pronounce that word. You just drop all the consonants. And it went anoxic from top to bottom, 30 meters deep. It was a period of several warm weeks, and hypoxia went through the permanent halocline and seeped up, and they had free hydrogen sulfide in the water, and it went on for a period of nearly 2 weeks. And these are eels trying to crawl out of the water, so it's pretty insidious. And I think the worst thing about hypoxia, or the lack of oxygen in bottom waters, is that it's spreading. And it's always this thing people start to look for it. So what you have to do is, where you have data, is look for time series to see, are we seeing more areas of hypoxia because we're looking for it, or they haven't been there before? And I wouldn't say by and large, they haven't been there before. And it has a lot to do with coastal, with nutrient inputs. And so if you plot these areas of human footprint, and it's often where you see lots of hypoxia, like around Europe. In China, there's a number of systems that are increasing in hypoxia. So it is a global problem. It's just not something that we face in the Baltic Sea. And it's because of eutrophication, and that's what brought me here to Scandinavia. We have all the terrible things associated with eutrophication, which is great to study. And you know, we have these cyanobacteria blooms, and in Denmark they wash up on the beach, especially when we get easterly winds. We have red tides and other harmful algal blooms occasionally. We have disruptions in food webs, and they're probably caused partly by eutrophication, but also by overfishing as well. And then we have these dead zones. And the causes of eutrophication, and Christoph gave the definition last night, and it's an increase in the supply of organic matter to the system. And of course, that supply of organic matter can come from a variety of places. Most often, it comes from nutrient inputs, but you should recognize that it comes from other places as well. For example, near sewage treatment plants, you can have raw or poorly treated waste coming in, and that organic matter will need to be decomposed. Around paper mills that used to be allowed to pour out fibers, you can have oxygen depletion as well. So it's really the increase of organic matter. And it really talks about that you fundamentally change the system too. You change it from a system that might have bottom communities with plants to one that's dominated by plankton communities. So it's really this focus on organic matter and not necessarily nutrients. But nutrients are certainly the cause of it, especially in much of the Baltic Sea. Have you guys seen these plots? Have they been presented yet? No, these are work from Bo Gustafson, and who's at the Baltic Nest Institute where Christoph is. And it's putting together the nitrogen loading and the phosphorus loading through time. And they made some assumptions about how much occurred in the past. And one of the things you see is you see this large increase in the 1950s with the industrialization of agriculture and the widespread use of nitrogen fertilizers as well. The interesting things, we've actually peaked in the 1980s and 1990, and we've seen declines in nutrient loading to the Baltic, and these come from a variety of different sources. The decline in phosphorus, a lot of it comes from sewage treatment plants and better dealing with fertilizer. And there have been some declines in nitrogen, but you shouldn't overestimate this because it's very jagged. And it turns out that nitrogen is very much dependent upon hydrology. So when you have wet years, you have much higher nitrogen loading than when you have a dry year. And we can look and see how much nutrients have to be reduced. And we still have many tons of nutrients to be reduced to reach these targets in the Baltic Sea Action Plan. And Christoph talked about that last night, about what kind of targets we're interested in. And I'll address this at the very end of my discussion today. This is from a Swedish Environmental Protection Agency report. It's in Swedish, but that's okay. So we define hypoxia as less than 2 milligrams per liter. You'll see a lot 2 milliliters per liter, and that's actually about 3.2 milligrams per liter. And it's just a number. And it's a number that was picked because that's where you start having large scale effects on organisms, especially things on fish as well. But you can see hypoxia is pretty much confined to the deeper basins, as was the answer to the question, especially here in the Gotland Deep. But it's actually both on the eastern Gotland Basin, but also on the western Gotland Basin. And it goes up into the northern Baltic proper and can extend into the Gulf of Finland if the conditions are right. And it averages something on the order of 49,000 square kilometers, which is incredible. It's larger than a size of a country. So it's actually larger than the country of Denmark. It's really amazing. And we're the largest anthropogenically induced dead zone in the world. And it's kind of fun because you walk around saying, oh, we're the biggest. But I don't think this is something to be proud of. So, I think we've made great progress in the last 10 or 15 years understanding hypoxia. Although I must admit, they've been collecting oxygen measurements in the Baltic for a long time period. There was this guy named Ludwig Wilhelm Wilkner who discovered the methodology and published it in 1888. And so there's oxygen measurements from the Baltic already from 1898. And I'll talk about that in a moment and the importance of that. But I think one of the problems has been is how do you deal with all this data from all these different stations? So in the past, they used to look at data like this, where you have a period of time, and this is from one station, BY-15 in the Gotland Deep. The important thing here, you see this is both in micromolar, but also in milliliters per liter. But the other thing here is you see negative oxygen concentrations. And the Baltic is the only system in the world where they report negative oxygen concentrations. And it's because there's lots of hydrogen sulfide in the water. And so it's the oxygen that's needed to oxidize that hydrogen sulfide. And so that's why they report these negative numbers in some places. But when you start looking at all the individual measurements, it's really hard to see trends. I mean, you can see that there has been an increase. There's more hypoxia in today than there was in the past. But I think one of the big things that came about, it was a paper that I was part of. And what we did was we used these large-scale tools to estimate what is the volume and the area that covers the bottom. And now when you see hypoxia being reported around the world, it's usually in what is the area that of hypoxia or the volume of hypoxia. And we put together this paper, and there was some data for the 1960s. We thought that the data wasn't enough to really do the kind of kriging that we were doing to try and estimate the amount of hypoxia. And we were also putting together two different time periods, and one was in January, February, March, and the other one was in the fall, and trying to look at how hypoxia changed also a little bit seasonally as well, which you really can't see in this, but it was also to get enough data. And you can see that the lowest period of hypoxia was actually in the 1990s. And what's important about this was a time period people still call the great stagnation period. And the last major inflow we had was at 1983, and it went a period for 10, 15 years, 20 years. It was a long period of time without major, so-called major inflows into the Baltic Sea. And so it varies a lot. And one of the interesting things is the lowest area of hypoxia occurred when we didn't have inflows into the Baltic. And I think this was something that really surprised us tremendously when we put this together. And it's still one of these things that people forget. And I'll talk more about that in several other slides here. And so what happens is that salt water comes into the system, and it actually creates more stratification in the system. It's harder to mix and break through that halocline. And then you have reduced mixing, you increase the residence time in the bottom water, you have more time for the oxygen to be depleted. But one of the problems too, you can plot these so-called major inflows, which are a certain amount of water that come into the Baltic. But it turns out that they're only a small percentage of the salt water that comes in the Baltic. Most of the salt water comes in at intermediate inflows. They don't come in these big major inflows. You know, they come in at a certain period of time, and they might have a temperature and a density, and they might stay at 80 meters and work its way through the Baltic. Or it might be 120 meters, depending on the density. Not all of them have the right temperature and the right salinity to sink to the bottom and replace the bottom waters. So it's actually not that simple. Where am I? So the question that we had was, how do we deal with this prior to 1970? And so I work with a guy named Jakob Carstensen, who's much, much smarter than I am. He's also this really brilliant statistician. And so he developed a method to hindcast oxygen or hypoxia in the Baltic from the sparse measurements we had. And so the first thing he had to do, there were lots of measurements of temperature and salinity. We actually reconstructed the water column of the Baltic Sea, like what is the salinity and temperature over this time period. And then we also then started to use the oxygen. And we were using, because they didn't have complete profiles, we started to use a method called apparent oxygen utilization. So how much oxygen is being used with time? So you develop these regressions that it keeps getting less oxygen down towards the bottom. So you get a regression on how much is being consumed. And then you can extrapolate that over larger areas. And so we put this paper together, and it was published last year in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. There are still gaps in the data during World War I and World War II. Christoph showed a version of this figure yesterday, and you can see that at the turn of the century, we had very few areas that had hypoxia. We think now that we didn't really catch it all. If you go and you look at the sediment data, there are some of the deepest basins of the Baltic that probably have been hypoxic for a longer period or intermittent hypoxic. There's this area that's 480 something meters deep, the Landsort deep.
459.
Thank you. And it's probably has been permanent hypoxic since the start of the Baltic Sea. And Christoph gave a number of something like 10,000 square kilometers. I think that's a little high, but you know, we're in the same ballpark. It increased in the 30s and 40s, and we started to see more widespread hypoxia in the Gotland Deep and these deeper basins. And then we had this, where we have a period of data, and this actually looks very similar to the data that I showed earlier, but there's more recent data here. And today we have the largest hypoxia areas ever. They're averaging between 65,000 and 70,000 square kilometers. It's just ridiculous.
And is this for the maximum hypoxia at a certain time?
So these are annual averages.
Annual averages.
Yeah. So that was how we did this. Yeah. It does vary throughout the year, and it varies depending on inflows, but we used the annual average. So, but you can see actually a large percentage of the bottom water is consumed of oxygen. You don't have to go too far down past the permanent halocline till you start to see hypoxia and then anoxia. And sorry, I'm really proud of this paper. But there are other things that fall out of this paper. We reconstructed the salinity and temperature profiles. And this is from the Gotland Basin. And if you look at the temperature, you can see we've had an increase of 2 degrees in temperature over the last century. So whether or not you believe in global warming, the Baltic is warming. And this actually has a big impact because warmer waters hold less oxygen in it. The salinity has also changed. This was the period where you had the great stagnation period when there weren't major inflows, and you actually had salinity started to decrease, and then changes in the permanent halocline. The lower salinity means increased mixing across the halocline as well.
Is the temperature and salinity from 200 meter depth? Right?
Yes. So my question to you, I'm going to change topics now. What do we know about coastal hypoxia? I know some of you have read my paper. So where is? Anyway, talk amongst yourself. 2 minutes on your mark. Get set, go. Anyone except those two who know it already?
I guess it occurs during the summer.
It occurs during the summer. Ah. So it's more seasonal than it is permanent. Okay. That's a good one. Any other things you can guess about hypoxia in the coastal zone? Does it happen in the Bothnian Sea, in the Bothnian Bay?
Probably not.
Okay.
But But in the Gulf of Finland, I have seen it in very shallow areas.
Yes, definitely in the Gulf of Finland. You also should remember that from his talk, because you have given your talk,
yeah,
didn't you?
I did.
Yes.
But I didn't talk about Gulf of Finland, I talked about archipelago.
Okay, yeah, yeah. Okay, so what do we know about coastal hypoxia? So there's class examples. There's places like Maya Fjord that went completely anoxic from top to bottom. We know that summer hypoxia occurs. That's the common thing that people know about. The famous examples are Gullmar Fjord, which is up on the west coast where Kristineberg Marine Station is. And then it happens in the Stockholm Archipelago, and it happens in the Finnish Archipelago. And it's also episodic, as we know, in some instances. You see occasional fish kills. But I think the amazing thing was, we have these great databases of the Baltic Sea, like from ICES and from SMHI. And so you can download data. Many of them are distributed databases, so you can go to one database and actually access data from a number of different databases. And it's incredible. But still, there's very few places that put data on their own coastal zones onto that website. And so we did this project a couple of years ago with money from Baltic Sea 2020, where we went around and we looked for data on the Baltic Sea. And we saw something like, I don't know, it was like 5 million records of data. It was just incredible. But it wasn't very well quality insured. And so we went through this process of trying to figure out how prevalent is hypoxia in the coastal zone. And so we took places and bin them into coastal units, because you might have one particular estuary that has three samples into it. And one of the things we found that 215 sites out of 613 have experienced hypoxia during a 10-year period. We took from the year 2000 to 2009. We didn't go into what has happened in the past, but this figure is from what has happened in the past. There is also a trend of decreasing oxygen in many of these systems as well. But we walk through this, and we can see this whole coast of Poland and Latvia and Lithuania and Belarus, and we see Estonia, and here there's almost no hypoxia along here. And why is that? What are the two conditions?
Because of westerly winds.
Yeah, no stratification. You have lots of mixing, so there's no enclosed areas, so you know everything gets washed away. And you see up here in the Bothnian Sea and the Bothnian Bay, there are little red marks. So why do you think that is? Are there from lots of people there putting sewage in and growing algae?
Estuaries.
Yeah, they're estuaries. They're enclosed. But what's the other factor? It's stratification and it's organic matter. And these are paper plants. These are paper mills that for very long periods of time had no or very little regulation, and they put fibers into the water. And there are fiber banks in some of these estuaries that are still sitting there and consuming oxygen. And they're historical, and they'll be there for a long time period until they're buried and are washed away or whatever. And then you can see the most of them actually occur in these enclosed areas along the coast, and especially in the archipelagos. And the black dots are when it's anoxic, and the red dots are when it's hypoxic. And so what we also did was we tried to figure out how often it occurs. And so never, I've already told you it was 213 out of 600 or something like that. It's about 40%. Have experienced hypoxia, a little less than 40%. And we divide it into persistent. And when you're dealing with these large database with lots of numbers, you have to be a little bit generous. So we said persistent is 90% of the time. So how many estuaries are in the Baltic Sea do you think are permanently hypoxic? We know Maya Fjord and Gummar Fjord. Any guess? Very many of them? Are they the only one? Is it 10? Is it 100? Is it 20? 5%? Okay. It's actually 1.5%. So it's only 7 places that have this permanent hypoxia. We talked about it happens seasonally. And again, it depends on how you define things. So we define things, it had to be from June, and depending on where you are, either September or August, depending on what climatic zone you were in. And it turns out that only 4% of them are seasonal. And the reason is that it often happens for short periods, or it's episodic, which was the largest fraction. And I'll show you one of the reasons why. This is from Denmark. This is the Limfjord, and there's a number of different estuaries here. I forgot to look at my calendar. Week 32, that's like the second week of July or the third week of July? Third week of July. And you can see that they were looking at hypoxia and strong hypoxia. And strong hypoxia is actually less than 2 milligrams per liter, and that's less than 4. So it was primarily confined here, but you had lower oxygen areas here. And if you look at the monitory data a week later, it actually had spread considerably. It was both in the northwestern part of the Limfjorden, it was in the central basin, and down here in Skiva Fjord. 2 weeks later, you had winds, and it all but disappeared, except to some very confined places. So when you do this kinds of analysis that we were doing, and we were trying to say it need to occur during a certain time period. So I would say that it happens every year in the Limfjorden, but it's episodic. And so that's one of the problems when you start dealing with these databases and then trying to make inferences about what has happened with time. Okay. And then we have the Stockholm Archipelago. And this is from Solofjorden. And this is 2 milligrams per liter. And you can see it truly is episodic. There's this strong annual cycle where you have high oxygen concentrations during the winter and spring. It gets depleted in the summer. And then they measure some years where it's hypoxic. And then it appears that it has gotten less hypoxic with time. And that's one of the observations that they've seen in the Stockholm Archipelago. And there's several different explanations for this. And one of them is that you've turned off all the knobs of nutrient inputs into the archipelago. You have reduced nitrogen and phosphorus, and especially the urban inputs. But there's also this organism called Marinsellaria that has come in. And they also can tend to mix the surface sediments, and they can tolerate low oxygen concentrations. And they're believed to have had an effect as well on conditions in the sediments. Let's see. I have one more thing I'm going to talk about, then we take a break. What are the effects of major saltwater inflows into the Baltic? I'm going to pound this into you. You're going to agree with me when I'm done. So, 2 minutes, okay? What are the effects of major saltwater inflows? Okay. I'm ready for some answers, please. Stratification. Right. Definitely. I would agree with that. That's amazing that you come up with that. You're listening. Marcus.
Oxygen.
Absolutely. It brings in oxygen. That's really important.
More primary production.
More primary production. How does that happen?
Because there's oxygen.
Okay.
So you can use it.
Okay.
For a short time.
Okay. Okay, so let me go through. I just have a few slides here. And so this is actually this classic slide from the Swedish Environmental Protection Agency. I've converted it to English. But it's, you have these major saltwater inflows. They come in and they follow along the bottom and they flush out the bottom. And so, and it brings oxygen with it and it brings salt water. And so if you go to the popular press and you actually ask most scientists, I would say that they would answer saltwater inflows are good for the Baltic. And this is what frustrates me so much, because I know it's so wrong. But you can tell me if I'm wrong. But they, you know, you have other factors that occur, and we've talked about many of those. We can look at this recent inflow into the Baltic. You know, this December, January period, we had lots of water come in. Did you guys talk about this? And this is data from SMHI. It's great. They come off the cruise within 2 weeks. They have reports out. I don't know if you have access to the raw data, but they have figures here. We have the salinity and we have the oxygen. And you can see the water coming into the Baltic Sea. You have higher salinities already in the at the end of February in the Bornholm Basin. And you can see the salinity is going to work its way down. It's heavy. It's up around 15 to 17, and it's going to make its way down into the Gotland Deep. You can see this huge area of anoxia in the Gotland Deep. And you can see how these basins now have oxygen in them. And then if we jump ahead to July, one of the things that we can see is that it's getting saltier in the eastern Gotland Basin, and which means that there's salt water penetrating in there, or it's also pushing water ahead of it too. That's the other thing it does. It acts as a wedge, and you know, this bottom water comes in like this, and it's pushing water further along, and actually it pushes it up to the surface as well, or closer to the surface. And you can see that already in the eastern Gotland Basin, we're starting to have evidence that there's oxygen in there. And that's what Marcus talked about, and that's the most important thing. And this is what people see, and that's what they have been talked about, and that's why I think we have that previous picture. But what's interesting is everyone is onto this. SMHI, the people at IOW, at the Baltic Sea Research Institute, and there's been meetings talking about collecting more data during this time period to watch what happens. But one of the things that happens a lot is this salt water is going to get moved up into closer to the surface waters, and it's going to get mixed up. And so one of the things that we see often is that 1 or 2 years after saltwater inflow, we actually have more cyanobacteria blooms because we have more phosphorus in the water. And the other important thing, we see oxygen here today. You have to remember, this has been without oxygen for decades, really. And it's gonna consume all the oxygen that's there. There's places in the Gotland Basin with 20% by weight of organic material. So there's a lot of decomposable material there. And there's a lot of equivalents of reduced equivalents that have to be oxidized that's in there. So this is gonna disappear quickly. I think it's gonna be interesting because there's a lot of people studying it to see how quickly it's gonna disappear. Because I think that's an important number for trying to predict the future. And the last thing, I just wanted to say that I'm right. That was one of the things that we predicted here. And to tell you a little story, we wrote this paper, we submitted it to Nature. It went through 2 rounds of reviews. And there was a group, it turned out that we found out later, both of them were from the same institute. And they didn't want us to come out and say that major Baltic inflows were bad. So we ended up not getting the paper published in Nature, and it got published in Environmental Science and Technology. It's heavily cited. I'm happy about it. The data is out, but it's interesting how these politics also get into science as well too. Okay, we're going to take a 15-minute break. Let's come back at 3, so we'll take a 12.5-minute break. Okay, I'm going to start with another question. Is hypoxia a natural feature of the Baltic Sea? I mean, we want to get rid of it, but hasn't it been here a long time? So, talk, please. Is it natural?
Yes.
So we don't need to worry about it. Or are there subtleties here I'm missing? Okay, let me talk about it. So I'm interested in looking at how hypoxia occurs in the past and what are the mechanisms that bring us into the hypoxia, and more importantly, how do we get out of it? How do we get rid of hypoxia? And so we've been working on this question for a while, but we first started out, we'd gotten money from Baltic Sea 2020 that wanted to fix the Baltic Sea by the year 2020. And they were looking for advice. And so we went through a number of different geoengineering options. But to get there, we felt we had to understand more about hypoxia. And we started to look at the literature, strangely enough, and read papers that were published mainly in geological journals, but looking at hypoxia in the past. And there were big wars in the geological community because people would take a core and they would see a certain pattern, and someone else would take a core in a different basin and see a different pattern, and they would say, your core is wrong, my core is right. There's problems with dating. It turns out that hypoxia varies depending on how deep you are in the basin, whether you're in the Eastern Gotland Basin or the Western Gotland Basin, you're gonna see different patterns. But we put together all the data, and that's what I'm gonna talk about. And actually the first piece of really cool data is by Sven Hille, who is at the Institute for Baltic Sea Research. And they took tons of sediment cores in the Gotland Deep and looked at them visually. And when there's been hypoxia and it's there for a long period, you tend to have laminated sediments. You have these little bars. You can definitely see they're high in organic matter, and there hasn't been animals mixing them. And he found that in depths greater than 150 meters, they were all hypoxic, and they dated them. So somewhere about 100 years ago, and this was published in, the cores were taken in 2003, the Gotland Basin, the sediments became anoxic. Doesn't mean the water column did, but it also probably meant that there was hypoxic problems in the water column. And that's interesting, but if you went before that 100 years, it actually was oxic. And so that kind of screwed things up. So when did it happen before? So we put together these different papers, and we put together this generalized picture. In the Baltic Sea, you had something called the Anslis Lake. And due to sea level rise and the sinking in the Danish Straits, salt water started to come into the Baltic Sea and formed what's called the Litorina Sea. And this is the area of the Øresund in the southern Baltic. And it actually opened up much, much more as sea level rose. But then you also had the land rising a bit too. So it actually reached its peak and opening about a couple thousand years into the Baltic being formed. And one of the interesting things is you have hypoxic periods for almost 2,000 years in almost every place you look in the Baltic Sea. And sometimes you see some short periods of oxic waters. There were many of them that had some kind of discontinuity in the middle where it was oxic again. And then, strangely enough, it became oxic for nearly 2,000 years. And then somewhere around the Roman climate anomaly, and it's also called the Great Migration, because the Roman Empire broke up. All these people moved up to Scandinavia, and they then you had this period during the medieval warm period as well, and then you have the modern period. So why did we get hypoxia during this time? And what people have shown is that when the salt water came in, you changed how phosphorus is cycled. You had sulfate reduction. And sulfate reduction participated in the iron cycle, so all this iron oxide that was binding phosphorus actually release phosphorus into the water column. And that was probably drove organic matter that caused the first periods of hypoxia. But then it became much stronger stratified. And that was probably the cause of this 4,000 year period. But then it disappeared. And we just had a paper published last year. And it's, again, it's a story about this isostatic uplift. The fact that we had a glacier, you know, over this part of the Scandinavia that was over 2 kilometers high. And it pressed down the land. And the land is still popping up. So here along the high coast of Sweden, it's popped up like 120 meters over the last 8,000 years. It's really spectacular. And that had lots of consequences to what the morphology of the Baltic Sea is. And so if you look, I should back up. There's a sill here across the Finnish archipelago going towards Stockholm today. That's at about 50 or 60 meters. And before, that sill was probably 100 meters lower. And so when when you had this period of hypoxia in the Baltic Sea during the Holocene thermal maximum, probably the whole Baltic Sea was hypoxic, including the Bothnian Bay. And then in today's Bothnian Bay, one of the things that you see is that it has oxygen and it has low salinities. And so this raising of the landmass stopped the flow of water between those two basins and disconnected those basins. And one of the things it did is, because it was oxic, it meant that phosphorus could accumulate in these basins. And so if we go to cores in the Bothnian Sea, we see this period of hypoxia, but it lasted for a much shorter period. And whereas it was a longer period. And so we think that one of the reasons that hypoxia disappeared, it wasn't only the fact that salinity conditions changed, but the fact that you developed a sink for phosphorus in the Bothnian Sea. And so there were two different mechanisms to get rid of hypoxia. So the tough question comes, how did we get hypoxia during this period? Was it simply a climate? Is it simply warmer climate means more hypoxia? We know it has an influence because it speeds up rates of metabolism. It also does things. There's less oxygen that's soluble in the water column. But we have a hypothesis, and it's still a hypothesis. But we actually think that the people that came during this great migration had a big influence on the Baltic. If you go to land use records and you look past through time, you can see a large-scale land clearance during this time period. They also brought the iron plow with them, and they started to churn up soil profiles. And we actually think it had to do with nutrient inputs as well, that it just wasn't climate. It was also man had an effect on it. But then how could it just stop? And there are two reasons we believe that are possible. And one of them, you had the plague come, and Sweden lost half its population. So people died, and they moved into cities, and farms were abandoned and the agricultural expansion stopped. And you also had colder climate. It was during the Little Ice Age as well. And so those things probably interacted together. And then it came back 100 years ago in many places in the Baltic. And it probably is due to nutrient loading. So I think the biggest question is, how do we get out of hypoxia now? We have put in many tons of phosphorus into the Baltic Sea. We've changed nutrient biogeochemical cycles. We're still putting nutrients in. And and we'll come back to that at the end. I'm running out of time, so I'm going to skip that one, unfortunately. So what are the consequences of having hypoxia? 1 minute. What does hypoxia do? What are the consequences of having hypoxia today, besides having no oxygen in the bottom water?
Benthic animals die.
Absolutely. And what feeds on benthic animals?
Fish.
So we probably affect the health of fish by removing one of the food resources. You probably also change the ability of cod to reproduce, because they tend to produce in the saltier waters. But my big thing, which I really like, is the impact on biogeochemical cycles and what it has done to both the phosphorus and the nitrogen cycle. So the cycling of nutrients today in the Baltic Sea are very different from what they have been in the past. So this was part of that paper we published in ES&T in 2002. And the pretty colors are the dissolved inorganic phosphorus, the phosphate in the water column. And the lines are oxygen. And you can see during this period where there's no oxygen in the water column, is phosphorus pours out of the sediments. And what happens is the lack of oxygen reduces iron oxides, and phosphorus is absorbed to those iron oxides. And so we lose the sediment sink of phosphorus. So actually, a large percentage of the phosphorus that we've added into the Baltic is not buried in the sediments. It's not flushed out of the sediments. It's sitting below the halocline, waiting to be mixed back up into the water column. And so that's one of the problems that we have. We have this large source of phosphorus that's in the Baltic. And it has a big effect on cyanobacteria. So on these sediment cores that we've worked on in the Baltic during these three periods of hypoxia, we've also looked at cyanobacteria pigments using HPLC, and we've used zeaxanthin. And one of the things that you see is during these periods of hypoxia that you have lots of cyanobacteria during these time periods. And when you don't have hypoxia, you don't have these periods. We also use things like different ratios between pigments and carbon to show that it's not just a diagenetic effect. It's actually a real effect in the amount of cyanobacteria. And so one of the things that we think is that there's less cyanobacteria when we don't have periods of hypoxia. And when you have periods of hypoxia, you're going to have the phosphorus available to grow more cyanobacteria. So if we can get rid of hypoxia, it means that we can also reduce the abundance of cyanobacteria in the Baltic Sea. This is partly called the vicious circle. And what happens is you have organic matter coming down, growing on nutrients. It goes to the bottom. It decomposes. You end up getting hypoxia. Phosphorus comes pouring out. It eventually gets mixed up into the water column. And you have high availability of phosphorus. And then you have organisms like cyanobacteria that can fix nitrogen, that don't need to worry about the nitrogen in the water column. They fix nitrogen and they produce more organic matter. It goes down to the sediments and it keeps this cycle going with the phosphorus. And so that's one of the reasons that we need to reduce the amount of phosphorus in the water column because of this vicious cycle. The other thing about cyanobacteria is that they like it when it's warm. So during these time periods where we've had warm periods and we've had hypoxia, we probably have more cyanobacteria because the temperature tolerance. They need temperatures above 18 degrees centigrade to really proliferate. I need temperatures above 20 for me to swim in the Baltic Sea. So I understand this. And so they like it hot. And so one of the projections is as it gets warmer, we will have more hypoxia in, or more cyanobacteria blooms. But it's not only phosphorus that is an important nutrient in the Baltic, it's also nitrogen. And that's the weird one. Because if you look and if you plot the amount of dissolved inorganic nitrogen, so that's the amount of ammonium, nitrite, and nitrate versus hypoxic volume, one of the things you see is this this negative regression. So the more volume of hypoxia that you have, actually the less nitrogen you have in the water column. And this is really puzzling because most of the nitrogen is lost through denitrification. And that often happens in sediments, and it has to happen where you have oxygen in the water column, and it happens in the sediments. So actually, if you would ask me what I would expect, I would expect a relationship like this, that when we had less hypoxia, we would have less nitrogen in the water column because of that link. And so one of the reasons that we explain this is the same reason you go and we're looking at in the ocean. And I don't know if you guys have ever heard of these oxygen minimum zones, these areas of oxygen like off of Peru, and off of, it's in the Red Sea, it's in a variety of different places off of coastlines where there are permanent areas of hypoxia. And where there's permanent areas of hypoxia, you have all these redox equivalents there. And you can have actually denitrification occurring along this redox cline. And so in the Baltic, when it's healthy and we have oxygen, most of the denitrification occurs in the sediments. But in this program that we had, we were making measurements of denitrification in the water column. And which is very similar to what they see in these oxygen minimum zones. And they're very difficult measurements to make. Nanomolar levels of oxygen will interfere with the process. So you have to do things like take your CTD and send it down into the anoxic bottom water and let it sit there for at least an hour to get rid of all traces of oxygen. The rubber stoppers they use for their incubation vessels, they keep bubbling in nitrogen for a period of 3 months before they even take them out and use them. So you have to go to extremes. But if you go to those extremes, you can actually measure lots of denitrification in this chemocline where you have this shift from oxic conditions to anoxic conditions. And it's actually hydrogen sulfide that acts as the electron donor to reduce to help with the denitrification reaction. And so the Baltic Sea is much more like an oxygen minimum zone today than it is of a normal system because of this. So if we look towards the future, this is something that Marcus Meyer published in 2011. I had it redrawn, and it was looking at what we can look for in the Baltic in the future. Have you talked about this graph yet, Marcus? Or? And so it's the area of hypoxia from their model. It's from an ensemble of models. It's from three different models. And you see this increase in time. And you have three different scenarios here. So if we don't do anything, it's going to get worse. But eventually, you're going to reach a limit because you're going to have hypoxia all the way from the permanent halocline down. You can also keep the nutrient inputs constant and not increase them. So it means no growth in nutrients, or you can reduce them. And if you implement the Baltic Sea Action Plan, is we're going to reduce the amount of hypoxia. But the important thing is we're not going to get rid of it. And I think that's really important. So we're going to have to find a way to live with hypoxia. But if you go back and you look at the Baltic Sea in the 1950s, it had hypoxia of 30 to 40,000 square kilometers. And it was considered a healthy sea. So if we can reduce the levels beyond what we have now, the 65 to 70,000 square kilometers, we can have a better Baltic Sea than we had before. But some people aren't happy with this. If you look at the time frame, it's really the next 80 years. I'm not going to see it in my lifetime. You guys might not see it in your lifetime. Maybe your kids will see it in their lifetime. And that upsets people. They would like to see it happen quicker. And so people are talking about geoengineering. And geoengineering is often used for climate, but it's the deliberate large-scale manipulation of an environmental process that affects the Earth climate to counteract the effects of global warming. We've also been using it in terms of what are some of the things they're going to do that have been proposed for the Baltic Sea. If you're interested in geoengineering, there's a number of reports by both the Royal Society and the U.S. National Academy of Sciences that talk about different things that they're doing are what they can do to change the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. And I think today, all the science foundations are saying we can't remain ignorant about this. We have to study what the potential of geoengineering is for the climate. So my question for you is geoengineering the solution for the Baltic Sea? So I'm going to give you 2 minutes, maybe 3 minutes to discuss this. So what do you think? Does anyone have an opinion before we start talking about it? Is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing?
I can't decide.
You can't decide? Okay. That's good.
It depends on the time scale when you want to see the result.
Okay. Yeah.
And I guess it's something where it's really hard to include all the consequences.
I think one of the first questions you need to think about when you talk about geoengineer. So what do you want to fix? What do you want to geoengineer? Do you want to get rid of the algae? I mean, when we started this process, I started to get all these phone calls from these people. And one of them was a guy that he had developed a filtration system that you could take on a ship and, you know, drive around the Baltic and suck all the phytoplankton out of the water. And, there was this group of students from Gothenburg who actually got seed money to build a giant battery, these large pieces of plastic with wires down them. And you would put one half in the oxic part and one half in the anoxic part, and it would oxidize all the sulfate. You see this in ship chains sitting in the mud. And it's a well-known process. But if you've ever worked at sea and gone out on a boat, and even their test thing was like 10 meters times 10 meters and how you get these two things flapping in the wind to behave. I mean, it was just crazy. People would call me up from their basement. Oh, I have this, you know. Anyway, so what do you want to engineer and why? Why is geoengineering promises rapid improvements? And that which you ask, what is the time scale? So we don't have to wait 80 years. If we can implement something, we can get it done now. And wouldn't that be great? The other one that some people are saying is geoengineering is a cheaper alternative. And you think about it, and you think about building sewage treatment plants all around the Baltic and making advanced sewage treatment and removing phosphorus and having denitrification and nitrogen removed as well, and changing agriculture, and putting on these smart solutions that Christoph was talking yesterday, it's going to cost bundles of money. And so we just geoengineer our way out of it. The other one, it's popular in the media, and it's politically attractive. Think if you were the political party that said yes to geoengineering, and they implemented it, and you fixed it, you would be like elected forever. So, but we also have to think about other things too, and we have to think about society. I mean, if you listen to Marcus, I think he's one of the people that can wax and wane about how wonderful the Baltic Sea is. He is so thrilled to be here and go swimming 5 times a day. And it's an important part of our being, and it's especially important in Sweden. I know it's not as important as some other countries, but the Finns, my God, you love the archipelago and going out during the summer. But it's this thing, we think that we have the power as man. You know, we can make decisions, we can manipulate the environment. And I fully believe that if we wanted to do some of these things, we can do it. We've sent a man to the moon. We've made dams that have stopped rivers, and so rivers no longer make it into the ocean. So I think we could do this if we wanted to. But the question is do we want to? Or is it really the right thing to do? So we ran a series of things. Marcus was one of the leads on this, where we had to make simple models and ask some very simple questions. And the first one was, can we add oxygen to the Baltic? And how much would you need to add? And so the hypoxic area averages 49,000 square kilometers. We would need 2 to 6 million tons of oxygen per year. And so to put this in perspective, this is these high pressurized railroad cars of liquid nitrogen. You would need 20,000 to 60,000 railroad cars every year to go through your hometown and be deposited at the bottom of the Baltic Sea in order to fix it. It's just a ginormous problem. And so you can't. So people were talking about this Russian pipeline that they're going to put from St. Petersburg down to Germany. Let's put aerators there. And you can see that would be a completely hopeless task to try and add it. And so we did a series of model experiments. And we couldn't, there were so many different suggestions. So we decided we would increase the oxygen exchange across one of the main sills in the southern Baltic. So we would basically, we doubled the depth. That would be like dredging it out. And we left the sill in the Øresund open so ships could come in. So there was still a little bit of salt water coming in, but it would stop the major inflows. Lo and behold, more salt water gave more stratification and more hypoxia. We closed it. Let's turn the Baltic Sea into a lake. And that could happen as well. But it takes 30 years or more for it to improve. And then it would make it worse in the meantime. And then it was this halo climb ventilation. We could mix waters downward and add oxygen. And this is the one that actually has been one of the ones that have been looked at the most carefully. There were two projects. There was one called Box, where they took a fjord north of Gothenburg, and they wanted to use windmills, but they couldn't use a windmill for a variety. It was a short-term project. So they used pumps, and they pumped water downward. And what they did was they changed the salinity stratification, and actually they caused inflows to come in, and it flushed out the bottom water, and it brought oxygen back in. You really can't pump enough water downward. There's not enough oxygen and water there, so you have to change the circulation patterns to do this. And they were able to do it for this short period of time in the basin. They were helped because there were probably climatic things that happened that when this inflow came in, which they come in periodically. And then you had the Proppen project, where they just had a pump, and they were bringing warmer, less salty surface waters off the Helsinki and pumping it downward into this area, Sandofjorden, and off of Helsinki. But the warmer water increased temperatures by 2 to 3 degrees. It increased metabolism. It increased regeneration of nutrients. They had ammonium concentrations that were in the millimolar range. It was like what you find in sewage treatment plants and raw sewage. And so they've decided that that actually wasn't the best thing to do. And they've tried it in a small enclosed area in the Stockholm archipelago. And they did it during the winter. And it was working, but one of the problems was there's lots of hydrogen sulfide in the water. And they were bringing lots of hydrogen sulfide up. And then they got scared because hydrogen sulfide is toxic. And so they shut it off. Yeah, and so those were the two things. And based on that, this professor at Gothenburg University, Anders Stigebrandt, got more money from the Swedish marine authorities to try and look into putting a windmill. The windmill means you don't need electricity for the pump, and that's really expensive to pump that much water. So you would have the windmill pump water downward and try and fix it. But there's this thing about who decides, who says it's okay to put a windmill at the front of the Baltic where the inflows come in. And so in their application process, they said, it's it's one country. There's this thing called the ESPU convention, and one country could decide. And in Denmark, it's the energy authorities, you know, because you're going to deal with the windmill. So they would decide. So they would send an application to them. And then it means it wouldn't go to the environmental authorities. They also decided that they would try the Helsinki Commission. And the Helsinki Commission said no. And you know how hard it was to get the Baltic Sea Action Plan. Could you imagine trying to get every country in the Baltic to say yes to this? I don't think that it would happen. But it's interesting. They keep trying and they keep working on it. I think that there's some scientific questions we have to answer beforehand. How much would phosphorus or nitrogen be reduced? We know we've put in many more tons of phosphorus in the Baltic. If we just added oxygen, is there actually enough iron there to bind it and keep it in the sediments? We know right now a lot of the denitrification occurs in the water column. If you oxygenated the water column, would the sediments have the capability to take over that role again? How would it react to more inflow events? Would you you would have this balance between trying to get it mixed up in saltwater inflows. And so they have suggested that you would put somewhere between 1 and 200 windmills scattered throughout the Baltic is what they would need. And now Anders Stigebrandt said, if you did it for 10 years, all the phosphorus would go to the bottom, and then we could get rid of the windmills and we would have a healthy Baltic Sea again. But Anders Stigebrandt doesn't believe in nitrogen as an important nutrient in the Baltic. And he also believes, not based on any model or any calculations, that just adding oxygen is enough to get rid of the phosphorus. I also worry about destabilizing the system. So what happens when you reduce this stratification potential by mixing water downward? Can you break through the permanent halocline? You saw from one of my figures, we have a permanent halocline between 70 and 90 meters. What happens if water started to mix all the way down? What does it do to the biological communities if you no longer have that stratification? What happens to the phytoplankton and the zooplankton and the larva of fish when that happens? I think there are also enormous costs. It's not just buying a windmill and running it. It's the fact that you have to service them and maintain them and carry them out. And all that cost incredible amounts of money. What would the effect be on shipping lanes? And also, would this reduce the money for nutrient reductions? You know, if you're putting these, it would cost, I forget the numbers. It's close to 2 billion Swedish, 2 billion euros or 2 billion Swedish kronor, I can't remember, it's a big number. What would that do to our efforts to reduce nutrients? And I think there's lots of things that we have to discuss before this happens, and it's not being discussed, it's just being promoted. There are a variety of other geoengineering activities. There's something called phosphor sequestration, and where you enhance the permanent burial of phosphorus in sediments by co-precipitation with aluminum or other compounds. And it's well known in sewage treatment plants, you can add alum, which is a aluminum hydroxides, and it will absorb the phosphorus and sink to the bottom. And so they've done this, Baltic Sea 2020 has done this in an estuary in the Stockholm archipelago that has a very low flushing rate. And they've actually plowed down alum into the sediments. I think it cost, it was a large number again. It's either 2 million or, I think it's 20 million Swedish kroner. So about 2 million euros to pump this down. The cool thing is there's no phosphorus in the water column. It turns out that it's still hypoxic. You know, there's still organic carbon there. It's still taking the oxygen out of the system, but it doesn't have phosphorus in it anymore. And I think that's really, it's fun. But the question is if you did this to the Baltic and something went wrong or you still had hypoxia, you can't reverse it. You know, once you put chemicals into the system, you just can't say, okay, this isn't working. At least with the windmills, you can turn them off and stop the process. But once you start adding chemicals, you can't. There are other, what I believe are even crazier ideas. There's changing trophic interactions, and there was this plan called, a project called Planfish. And it has to do with this thing where the big fish eat the grazing fish, and the grazing fish eat the zooplankton that eat the phytoplankton. So if you get rid of the small grazing fish, then you don't have to worry about the system, is that we'll have less algal blooms. And so they did this project in Sweden, tried it, and they could only do it in Swedish waters because you have these international waters and you have agreements between countries on how much you can fish. And they fished only for sprat, because sprat is a fish that we usually don't eat. It's very oily. It's used, they extract the oil and use it for fish feed. They first have to clean it of all the toxins, but that's another story. So they did this project. It actually is, you will not find a result of this project at all. There are a variety of different reasons for it. At the same time this project was doing its last year of funding, there were all these stories about the Baltic cod were starving. And I am not at all implying that, you know, that when they fished out the sprat that it had an effect on the Baltic cod. But it's these things that we don't know about. You know, we think it can have an effect. We think we're doing one thing, but we're doing something else to the ecosystem. And I think that's one of the biggest problems with in geoengineering. It's not the things that we know, it's the things that we don't know and we can't even imagine. And after it happens, you would go, oh yeah, that makes sense. But that's, you know, after the fact. So I think before we do any of these things, we have to examine them very carefully, scientifically, and have evaluations, and not just have the people that are proponents of it doing the evaluations. It's got to be some kind of international panels or group of experts or something that are hopefully unbiased to make these decisions and ask these questions. I actually believe we're on a pathway to a better ecosystem. If you do a search on Baltic Sea and eutrophication on the Web of Science, and you do Chesapeake Bay, which they claim is one of the most studied estuaries, or San Francisco Bay, you find out there's more references to the Baltic Sea than any other place. So I think it is the most studied place in the world. I think we have lots of basic knowledge. We have a number of books on the Baltic Sea. We have a monitoring and assessment program. We have countries that work together that use the same techniques and that intercalibrate with each other. And the data is available on the web. I think that is really incredible. And there's an assessment program where they look at the data and they try and make evaluations. We have a government and a management. We have the HELCOM, the Helsinki Commission, that just has been fantastic. It's bureaucratic, it's slow. You have to make compromises and agreements between countries. But I think we're in the right direction. And we have the Baltic Sea Action Plan. I think what we have to do is we have to continue to implement that. We're not going to fix the Baltic Sea by 2020, but we have to start the process. I also am worried about this. Everyone is so excited about getting money to do geoengineering that they're not looking at some of the innovative ways we can deal with manure and deal with other sources of nutrients. Yesterday, Christoph, last night, was talking about manure and ways that you can dry manure and use it for fertilizer again in a more sustainable way and move it around. We thought we had cured the problem with ships. I think there's something like 18,000 people that go out on ships every day that are flushing into the Baltic Sea. But the agreements really weren't as solid as we thought. And so they're still working on trying to stop that. We have regulated fertilizers, we're building sewage treatment plants, we're addressing stormwater sewage, and actually the amount of atmospheric deposition, especially of nitrogen, has decreased tremendously. So I think we're on the right direction. In fact, we just had a paper accepted to biological reviews, and this is something called the heat index, the HELCOM eutrophication assessment tool, and we took it and we applied it back through time for the last 100 years. And there's different indicators. We talked about indicators last night. It's chlorophyll, dissolved oxygen, benthic biomass, it's winter, nitrogen and phosphorus, it's secchi depth, and it's the amount of color in the water. And one of the things you see is the same sort of curve that you see for hypoxia. You see this more pre-eutrophication phase, this increase in eutrophication, this peak in eutrophication in the 1980s and into 1990s, but we see a decline. And I think everyone agrees that the Baltic Sea is getting better. And we tend to forget that. And especially when we talk about geoengineering, we say, we're gonna have to wait too long. We need to do this now. Instead of thinking, you know, we're one of the few areas in the world where you get countries to work together and you get people and governments to pass legislation and reduce nutrients. And I think that's really fabulous. So my perspective is nutrient inputs have stimulated the growth of algae, creating the largest human-induced dead zone in the world. Geoengineering promises rapid improvements, but I think the potential effects of geoengineering can be devastating to the ecosystem. And we have to think carefully before we do that. And we should continue to focus on the prescribed nutrient reductions. So thanks for listening.